That song, Good to Me, sung by a woman named Audrey Assad. Kelly, actually, who plays piano, first shared that song with me, I don't know, a year or so ago. It's become a favorite song of mine. Almost every Monday morning in my office, I get in early and to think about the week ahead and pray and get things in order, I put that song on repeat. People joke about it and play over and over again coming out of my office. And I think Ali sings it better than Audrey Assad, but anyway. Because it proclaims a powerful truth that we need to hear over and over again. We're tempted to doubt it, but God is good to us. He's been so good to us. And maybe you've come here and you need to hear that. Just in terms of the song, you need to hear that sung over you, that God is good to you. That his goodness and mercy will follow you all of your life. That you'll trust in his promise. But I'm going to guess, if you're like me, you don't have to raise your hand, but I'm going to guess at your response. That is, there have been times in your life when you've been tempted to question or doubt his goodness. Is that true for you? No? And I told you not to raise your hand, but how many of you haven't at one time or another wondered if God is really good? I have. If the pastor puts his hand up, do you feel better? Right? And most often for me, and probably for you, it's circumstances. Something happens internally by my own doing, or something happens that I didn't cause or ask for. And it's painful, and it's hard and disappointing and confusing, and it hurts, and I wonder, where is God in this? Because this doesn't feel good. How can God be good? Or maybe it's not even something you personally, it happens to you, but you look out at the world, and you question God's goodness. Whatever your political ideologies, we can agree. There's no question. There are tragedies happening. In the refugee crisis, people are dying. And this is not actually new. We're just getting better at exploiting each other and oppressing each other and killing each other. Maybe you look out at the world and your heart breaks and you think, how can God be good? In fact, in my work as a pastor, I've talked to people who've come to me and said things like, I've got some intellectual questions about the Bible. I have some academic or intellectual issues, doubts, and hang-ups. And I'll meet with these people over coffee, in my office, even in their homes at times. And there are good questions, and I try my best to answer them from a theological perspective or a historical perspective. But you know what I almost always find? That given enough time, you peel back enough layers, and the questions really aren't intellectual in nature. At their root, they're emotional, they're personal. They really, if you dig deep enough, they aren't really about so much intellectual questions as they are questions about the goodness of God. How could God allow this? How could this happen? Where is God in the midst of this? And the story we're going to look at this morning from the last chapter of the first book, Genesis, the end of the Joseph saga, it really, the story, the Joseph's whole narrative, but the story in particular, tackles these kinds of questions head on. The goodness of God and the presence of evil and brokenness in the world. One of the things the Joseph story tells us, if we're paying attention, is that with God, silence is not absence. And often when it looks like things are at their worst, God is doing his best work, although it's certainly not always immediately apparent. So let me recap the story to this point, and then we'll read the passage for this morning. It's really a tragic saga in many ways. And so you'll remember we just began the story. It's really the story of God's faithfulness in the midst of one rather dysfunctional family, beginning with Abraham called out of Ur. And Abraham has his son, the son Isaac, the child of the promise. And Isaac has a son named Jacob. You'll remember Jacob was the born younger of two twin boys. He was a smooth-skinned mama's boy. Jacob was the hairy daddy's favorite. And Jacob, of all people, should have known that when parents play favorites, things don't go well. But Jacob has 12 sons. And the second youngest of his sons is Joseph, who he favors above all others. So, you know, family dysfunction gets repeated in cycles, doesn't it? And we see it here in the story. And his brothers resent him. And Joseph, for his own part, is kind of clueless and a little bit arrogant. And his brothers hate him so much, they beat him and leave him for dead and then sell him into slavery. Sell their brother for silver coins. Dip his robe in animal blood and lie to their father and say your son was devoured. Joseph is sold as a slave. He ends up being purchased by a man named Potiphar to work as a servant in his home. Potiphar is a high-ranking official in Egypt's court. Joseph rises to power in Potiphar's house and then is falsely accused by Potiphar's wife, ends up in jail for something he didn't do, rises up again because of God's favor in his life, gets put in the high-ranking official in Egypt's court, and once again gets falsely accused and put in jail for the second time. And eventually, he makes it to the second most powerful man in the most powerful nation on earth, Egypt. It's really an amazing story. And because of his position, when a horrible famine strikes, Joseph is in a position to rescue his family, all of his brothers and their descendants, his father's house, provide for them, feed them, welcome them, and forgive them. And he does. But we pick up the story now after his father Jacob has passed away. And one more interaction with his brothers. Genesis 50, verses 15 through 21. When Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they said, "It may be that Joseph will hate us and pay us back for all the evil that we did to him." So they sent a message to Joseph saying, "Your father gave this command before he died. Say to Joseph, please forgive the transgression of your brothers and their sin because they did evil to you. And now please forgive the transgression of the servants of the God of your father." Joseph wept when they spoke to him. His brothers also came and fell down before him and said, "Behold, we are your servants." But Joseph said to them, "Do not fear. Am I in the place of God? As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, to bring about that many people should be kept alive as they have been, or as they are today. So do not fear. I will provide for you and your little ones." Thus he comforted them and spoke kindly to them. Now Joseph has, this is actually a repeat of what happened in chapter 45 when Joseph's brothers first received the forgiveness of Joseph. It's pretty remarkable. He puts the silver cup in the sack of grain, and they think it's to trick them into that they stole it and he would punish them, but it's actually to bring them back so he can forgive them. And he does, and he showers grace on them and provides food and homes for them, rescues the whole clan. And already said, "I forgive you." But now daddy has died, Jacob died. And it's as if his brothers realize that, you know what, maybe Joseph was only being good to us because our father was still alive. Now that Jacob passed away, he's the only buffer left. Now maybe Joseph's true heart of vengeance will come out and we're in serious trouble. And so they say to him, "Dad said, be nice to us," basically. Which is nowhere in the text, by the way. Jacob never says that to them, nor to Joseph. I think he meant it, but he doesn't. In other words, they're basically just pleading, concocting this story. Our father's last words were, "Don't kill us," you know. And Joseph weeps. Why does he weep? Why does Joseph cry when they beg him for mercy? I think he weeps because he realizes they haven't gotten it yet. He wants his brothers back, but what do they say? "We're only your servants, we're only slaves in your house." He wants full reconciliation, but it hasn't happened yet. His brothers still carry the shame and the guilt and the fear. And Joseph cries because they haven't yet received what he's offering them, full forgiveness. I think in many ways, this is sort of an aside point before we get into the point, which is Joseph is in the place of God in this story, in this way for us. I think God sometimes looks at us and our inability to grasp and to receive and to take in what he's done for us, what we celebrate at the table, that he says, "I forgive you. Your sins are removed from you. You carry no more shame or guilt. I love you. I welcome you. I want you in my family." And we walk around as if he's still going to zap us, as if he's still angry. He says, "You're free from that." I think it breaks God's heart when his children can't receive what he wants to give them. And in a way, that's why Joseph weeps. And the way Joseph responds to his brothers in these three verses, 19, 20, and 21, make up the 3 points of the sermon. A good sermon should have 3 points, right? Three shall be the number of thy sermon. You ever watch Monty Python? No? What are we talking about? Sorry. Derek Kidner, in his commentary on this text, says, each sentence of this threefold reply is a pinnacle of the Old Testament and New Testament faith. Number one, to leave all of the writings of your wrongs to God. Number two, to see God's good hand in man's malice. And number three, to repay evil with grace and forgiveness. Those look forward to Christ's likeness. In other words, Joseph's response here in these three verses is a picture of the gospel. It's so important for us, how he responds and what it has to teach us. They are the marks of a transformed life and heart, of a changed person. And they're the characteristics of a person who can go through this life full of its pain and brokenness and evil and still live with peace and hope. These three marks are present in Joseph's life despite all that he's been through. And they can be present in your life as well. The first is to avoid God's seat. Avoid God's seat. Don't put yourself in God's place. Notice the very first thing Joseph says to his brothers in verse 19. But Joseph said to them, do not fear. Am I in the place of God? He asks this question. Am I God? Am I in God's place? What does he mean by that? Practically speaking, Joseph is in a position of authority and power over them. He's number two in the most powerful nation in the world. He could wipe them out with a snap of his fingers. He could have them executed, no questions asked. He would be humanly justified in doing so. They sold him as a slave. He owes them nothing on a human level. And he holds all the cards, right? He's in control. So on a human level, he is God to them. But he says, I'm not God. Am I in God's place? That I should exact vengeance? That's not my role. I'm not judge. When Joseph says this in verse 19, he's pointing to a central theme throughout all of the Bible. And that's this. When you and I get into God's chair, it's the source of almost all of our issues. All of our issues, if you dig down deep enough, are really because you're putting yourself in some way in God's seat. You're not letting him sit in his seat. Let me give you some primary ways that we do this. First, trying to be your own moral authority is putting yourself in God's seat. Remember back to the very beginning of the story in Genesis 2, 1 through 3. Remember Adam and Eve in the garden, the beginning of the story of God, right? They had one command. How small was their Bible? They had one command. It fit on a fortune cookie. It was just a tweet, right? Don't eat of that tree, right? You had one job, right? One thing. And what was the temptation that came to them? What did the serpent say? You won't die, you will what? Be like God. That sounds kind of mystical to us. Sometimes I think we tend to think, was there like God juice in the forbidden fruit? What does it mean? I think it's very simple. It means you're putting yourself in his place. You're making yourself moral authority over your life, and you have no right to do that. You're a creature, not the creator. Do you really think you're qualified to be judge and jury over your own life? Do you really think that you have what it takes to decide what's right and best for you? Our culture would say, absolutely. Who better than you to determine what's right for you? That's not the story of the Bible. The story of the Bible is when you buy that lie and you get in that seat, bad things happen for you and those around you. The temptation is really practical and very relevant and contemporary, actually. It's every bit as present in our day. Here's how often I see it in our day. It looks like this. Well, you know, of course, back then, it was easier for them to believe what's in the Bible because, you know, they were, you know, much more credulous. I mean, they were less educated. They were less aware. But now we know that we can't accept everything in God's word because some of it is just so outdated and narrow and archaic. The phrase, but now, is so full of hubris, but we miss it in our culture. Think about that for a minute. But now we know. Can you remember yourself when you were 15 years old? Who can remember back to 15? Anybody? Were you more foolish at 15 than you are? If you're 15 now, just wait. When you were 15, were you more foolish now at 15 or 25 or 35 than you are now? Yeah, I was. What does that say? if your 15-year-old self was a fool to your 25-year-old self, and your 25-year-old self was a fool to your 35-year-old self, and your 35-year-old self was a fool to your 45-year-old self, it tells you this. You are currently a fool to your future self. Someday, you're gonna look back and think, I thought I knew, but I was an idiot then. Now, if you're the same kind of idiot that's a problem. We're all growing. So the hubris of saying, now we know. Then we didn't, but now we do. Think of the pride. It's saying, I know. I know what I will accept and what I will reject. It comes down to this. Does God in His Word get to determine what's right and wrong in our lives and our culture? Or does our culture get to determine what we accept as right and wrong from God's Word? When we make ourselves our own moral authority, we're in God's seat. Another way we put ourselves in God's seat is refusing to forgive. When you withhold forgiveness from someone else who's hurt you, who's wronged you, you're playing God. You're saying, I decide when you deserve forgiveness. Romans chapter 12, we're told, the Apostle Paul tells us that that's God's job. We are not judge. He is. C.S. Lewis, in his essay, The Weight of Glory, says, to be a Christian means to forgive the inexcusable in others because God has forgiven the inexcusable in you. There's no conditions for that. It's so tempting, though, for us to think, yeah, but you don't know how they're behaving, God. They're still doing the thing to me. They're still behaving in this way. They haven't asked for forgiveness. They aren't repenting of their sin. They aren't sorry enough. They haven't suffered enough. Brandon, could you come here? I asked him ahead of time. I'm not, so in case you're freaking out, don't call me. Let's pretend, this is a friend of mine, Brandon, that Brandon is a big jerk and he hurt me badly. He's not and he didn't, but let's just pretend. And this Bible represents the wound done to me. I've used this illustration before. I hope it's helpful for you. Grab it, don't let go until I tell you, okay? Most of us think forgiveness works like this. I'll forgive you if you seem sorry enough, if I think you've suffered enough, if you really mean it, if I believe you've earned it, right? And we play this little emotional tug of war our whole lives. And he can't receive it and I can't give it because I'm playing God. Thank you, you can go sit down. Thanks, Brandon. Did he do a great job? Let's hear it for Brandon. And again, we have no problems. Forgiveness works like this. Brandon, I forgive you. I'm letting that go. I release it. I offer it to you. Now, you might never pick it up, right? You might say, forget you, Pastor Jeff. I don't need your forgiveness. I didn't do anything wrong. And that means we can't be reconciled. There is a difference between forgiveness and reconciliation. Forgiveness is I'm releasing this because it's for me and for you. Reconciliation is you saying, I'm wrong and I'm sorry and I receive that forgiveness and I want to be back in relationship with you. Jesus at the table, that's what we celebrate, offers forgiveness freely. But it requires us repenting and laying down ourselves and saying, I need that. I'm wrong. Forgive me, Lord. So reconciliation is not the same thing as forgiveness. So Joseph here has forgiven his brothers, but they haven't been reconciled because they haven't received it yet. When you withhold that, when you hold on and say, not yet, trying to extract that extra pound of flesh, you put yourself in God's seat. Nothing good comes from that. Third, final way that we put ourselves in God's seat is when we have excessive, inordinate worry. Excessive worry. Think about that for a minute. You might think, well, I'm a worrier, but that doesn't mean I'm playing God. Yeah, actually, it does. Because what is worry if you get right down to the root of worry? Worry is essentially this. I know what should happen or shouldn't happen, and I don't trust that God's going to get this right. I know what needs to take place in this relationship, in this circumstance, and I'm not sure God's paying attention or sees it like I see it. Huh? Right? You say, I know better than God. And is He really going to come through? The more you get out of God's seat, the more manageable your anxiety and worry becomes. The more you stay in His seat, it becomes overwhelming and crushing. So get out of God's seat. I think God says to us in many ways, when we're unforgiving, when we're trying to be our own authority, when we're weighed down with cares we're not supposed to carry, I think God's saying, that's my chair. Get out of my chair. Let me sit there. Second thing Joseph says, or that does, is take God's view. Take God's view. Listen to verse 20 again, Genesis 5, verse 20. As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, to bring it about that many people should be kept alive. The saving of many lives, some of your translations say. How could he say this famous statement, you meant it for evil, God meant it for good? That's an astounding thing to say. He has a different perspective. Let me give you an analogy from the Grand Canyon. Anybody been to the Grand Canyon before? We've been there. This is not a picture I took because ours weren't that good. This is from Google. But I did see it. And, you know, when you're at the top looking down, it's breathtaking. You just see this. It's just so vast. But I remember the guide telling us that, one of the people that worked there saying that every year between 250 and 300 people have to be rescued from the bottom of the Grand Canyon because they're dumb. Because they hike to the bottom and think they can find their way out. They get off the trail, they think they know where it is because they're at the top. They say, oh, I can see how it all makes sense. I know where to go. They hike down and they get hopelessly lost and dehydrated. Some die even. Here's the point. How do you see the troubles and pain of your life? Do you see it from the bottom? This makes no sense. I don't know which way to go. I don't see how this is going to work out. You need a view from the top. At the top, there's a cool breeze, right? You're looking down, and it's gorgeous, and it's beautiful, and you see how it fits together. At the bottom, it can be deadly. Joseph says, you meant this for evil, but God meant it for good. He has a different view. See, at the bottom of the valley, it's an either-or situation. Either life is going good, and I feel like, therefore, God is good. Or life is horrible, and therefore, I question God's goodness. And we fluctuate between these two. Most of us. But Joseph's statement shows us that God has a different perspective. Joseph's statement says, life is difficult. In the words of Princess Bride, life is pain, Highness. Anyone who tells you differently is selling something. There's brokenness. People mistreat you. It's horrible. It's difficult. There's pain. There's real consequences. And God is good. God is good. And he's at work. And he's in control. And he's doing good things. And even though it might take years or decades or centuries or the last day of human history, he will bring his good purpose about. The Bible holds these things in tensions. It doesn't deny the reality of brokenness and pain and sin. It doesn't deny the fact that God is good. It holds these things in tension. It's a different view. You meant it for evil, and it was evil. It is not good, but God meant it for good. Meaning, even our worst deeds, selling your brother into slavery, can't overcome the goodness of our God. Some of you linear thinkers might be thinking, wait a second, if Joseph's brother sold him into slavery, and it was slavery that got him to Potiphar, and Potiphar that got him to Pharaoh, and Pharaoh that put him number two, and number two that saved his family, and his family comes back, and therefore God's purpose could be fulfilled, and eventually we get to Jesus, maybe it was a good thing they sold him. No. Children, do not sell your siblings. The Bible doesn't teach that. That's not good, right? It means there's real brokenness and pain, but God is bigger than that and able in ways that we can't possibly comprehend in the valley to overcome it. Paul says in Romans 8:28, for all things work together for good to those who love him and are called according to his purpose. We like to misuse that. All things work together for good, and we define good on our terms, meaning house, health, prosperity, safety, wealth. Call according to his purposes, which has much more to do with your character and your influence than it does your comfort or your security. I mean, you might also be thinking, well, does this mean that when we sin and screw up and cause pain, that it becomes like plan B, that God has to issue plan B? I used to think of God as the cosmic game show host. You know, like door number one, my perfect will for your life. Door number two, you still get to heaven, but it's not as good. Door number three, don't talk about door number three, right? You ever feel like that sometimes? And God's up in heaven going, let's see which door these fools pick. Do, 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 do. And we're down here going, which door is it? That's not how God works. The story of Joseph is that despite all these people choosing the wrong doors, God's still good. He's still at work. He's still bringing about his purposes. In other words, let me just put it this way. If you belong to Jesus Christ, you cannot ultimately screw up your life. Not ultimately. You can cause pain. You can cause brokenness to yourself and those around you. Absolutely. But you can't ultimately undo his good plan if you belong to him. Third and last. And by the way, I hope you see what an incredible resource that is for those of us that love Jesus. You can apply that to your heart. I get out of God's seat. He's in his seat. I don't belong there. And I need to take his view, not the view from the bottom, but from the top, and trust the one who sees even when I can't. And number three, live God's grace. This is the third and the final mark of a transformed heart. Listen to what Joseph says in verse 21. Verse 19, he says, I'm not God, so don't be afraid. Because if I was God, you should be afraid, because I'm not qualified for that job. But I'm not God. And in verse 20, he says, you meant this for evil, and it was evil, but God has a different plan. And he redeemed me, and he's going to redeem you through it. And in verse 21, he says, so do not fear. I will provide for you and your little ones. Thus he comforted them and spoke kindly to them. That sounds so simple, matter of fact, but it's so deep. Listen to what's happening here. Joseph's brothers deserve his judgment. And he does not judge them and condemn them. That's mercy. He doesn't give them what they deserve, which is punishment. It's mercy, not giving you what you deserve. But he goes beyond that, doesn't he? He doesn't just say, okay, fine. You're on your own. You're dead to me, but I'm not going to kill you. That would be merciful. What does he do? He says, don't be afraid. Not only am I not going to wipe you out, I'm going to bless you. I'm going to give you homes. I'm going to give you food. I'm going to give you resources. I'm going to make a place for you. I'm going to use my position to bless you. That's grace, right? So he not only doesn't give us what we deserve, he gives us what we don't deserve. This is a picture of Jesus. You and I, apart from his grace, deserve death, to be cut off. We have violated his commands. We have put ourselves in his seat. We have rebelled against him. And we do deserve the full weight of his punishment and wrath. But he doesn't do that. That's mercy. Not only he doesn't just go, okay, you're off. Better not do it again. He says, not only that, I'm going to shower you with my spirit. I'm going to give you a purpose. I'm going to call you into my family. I'm going to give you an eternal hope. That's grace. It gives you the ability to love even those who have harmed you. And by the way, points one and two are a prerequisite for point three. If you're out of God's seat and you take God's view, then you're ready to live God's grace and to extend it to people. But you can't do that if you're still in God's chair. But here's the thing. The story of Joseph is not primarily just an example for us to follow. I don't know about you, but sometimes you can get like spiritual nosebleeds if it's all about high examples to live up to. Do you know what I mean? Like if it's always just that, how can I be that forgiving? I'm not like him. I'm not like her. Do you ever feel that way? Like it's just these endless list of people that are spiritual superheroes. I hope the story of Joseph tells us that the Bible's full of people that are less than superheroes. But more importantly, Joseph is not an example you have to measure up to. Joseph is a signpost pointing you in a direction. His whole life is pointing you to someone else. Think about it. Joseph was sold for silver. Someone else was betrayed for 30 pieces of silver. Joseph was rejected by those closest to him. So was another man by his closest friends and followers. Joseph was falsely accused. So was another. Joseph was put in prison and in chains. So was another. Joseph is pointing us to Jesus, who actually is the only one qualified to be in God's seat because he is God. But Philippians 2 says he emptied himself. He stepped out of that seat. Why? To go to the cross. So that your life might be ransomed. To use his position. Isn't the cross the ultimate example of God taking human evil and turning it into something amazing? Using it for his good purposes. And if he can do that with Jesus, he can do that for you. I think the story is told to us. Joseph weeps because his brothers do not see his true heart for them, his true good. Joseph is a picture of Jesus. Jesus, I think, weeps when we can't recognize how good God is, how good he wants to be to us. Remember the song we sang right before the sermon, Good to Me? We're going to sing that again. And I want to encourage you as you sing it, let that be your prayer. This ancient, crazy story about this messed up family is really about the goodness of God who has been so good to you. And you know that in Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Father, forgive us for our short-sightedness and our forgetfulness, for losing sight or doubting your goodness. There are many things in our personal lives and in our world that can cause us to question, but thank you for this truth, this timeless, eternal truth, that you're good. There is evil, there is pain, there is brokenness in the world, and it's real, but you are still good. Now and always, you're good to us. We thank you and we praise you. Amen. Stay here all morning, listen to her. I hope this morning, before you leave, that maybe you needed to hear that. And you do hear it. God is good to you. And you know that through his son, Jesus Christ. If you need a prayer for any reason after the benediction, feel free to come forward at the close of the service. We'd love to pray with you. And by the way, those of you that came prepared to give, we receive our benevolent offering as you leave, which goes to meet the needs of people that are struggling in our church and in our community. And so we thank you if you came prepared to give. Now, brothers and sisters, go in the grace of the one who is good to you. His name is Jesus. Amen, and go in peace.